The three curses mentioned above are sufficient to make one as dull as a stone, void of spiritual knowledge, and preoccupied with materialistic education, which is nascence. After uttering these curses, Nandishwara then cursed the Brahmanas to continue in the cycle of birth and death because of their supporting Daksha in blaspheming Lord Shiva. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. So finally, Nandishwara curses Daksha as well as the Brahmanas. The specific curse for Daksha is that within a short time he'll have the face of a goat. And the reason here Nandishwara is giving is that Daksha has accepted the body as all in all. Therefore, he has forgotten the Vishnu Pada or Vishnu Gati and is attached to sex life only. So, you can see from the kind of context that we are discussing now, that even Nandishwara the default consciousness of even Nandishwara is that life is meant for remembering Vishnupada or life is meant for Vishnu Gati. It's a default understanding. Human being means he knows he is meant for, the life is meant for Vishnu Gati or going to Vishnu. It is understood. So that is here he says that therefore since he has forgotten Vishnupada or Vishnu Gati and therefore attached to sex life. So by default also no human being is supposed to get attached to sex life according to progressive spiritual values of life. And because of that alone Nandishwara, Daksha, the reasoning of Nandishwara is because you are so attached to this, your body as all in all, therefore you have ended up in this consciousness to offend Lord Shiva. If somebody thinks his body is all in all, then he is in complete ignorance. And further, later on, the Brahmanas were also cursed that you will continue in the cycle of repeated birth and death. So Brahmanas are supposed to, already they are situated in Brahman and they have to get mukti or freedom from birth and death. So that was also a default consciousness of every Brahmana in the Vedic society. To attain self-realization, to attain God realization was the aim of every intellectual. But today, you can see this curse of Nandishwara is operating practically on everybody. Every human being is practically attached to his body. And once you are attached to one's own body, then the attachment is to wife, children, house, property, this whole I and mine is a big illusion. Why it is a big illusion? Because that bubble of illusion is broken in one shot at the time of death. Entire bubble of illusion is broken. It is broken for your mind, it is broken totally. What you think as your body is finished. What you think as your mind, as your ego, all vanishes. You take, the soul goes to another body. It starts another life again. And then again the illusion begins, I am this, that particular body. So many lives we have told, I am this particular body. And then we take birth in the body. Every body goes from birth to death. The soul is beyond this body. And that is Brahminical knowledge or the spiritual knowledge. And that self-knowledge that I am not this body, but I am part and parcel of God, I am part and parcel of Krishna, I am servant of Krishna. That self-knowledge is forgotten, and that is why the living entity is thinking that this body is myself. Self-knowledge, what is self-knowledge? Self-knowledge is something that is always accompanying the self. Who is? Just like when you are in this body, if somebody asks who you are, you'll say, I'm this body. So this is called self-knowledge. But this is false self-knowledge. The soul has a self-knowledge that he is part and parcel of God. He is servant of God. That self-knowledge is covered and he thinks that this body is the self. So this consciousness of forgetfulness of the self and misidentifying the self with something else, that is the entire material existence. And this is so wonderfully crafted, designed, crafted, whatever you want to call, by the Creator, by the Supreme Lord, that this body-mind mechanism is like a physical, psychological, and biological machine. This body is like a physical, psychological, biological suit over the soul. Just like you wear dress, the same way, it's not ordinary dress. It's a robot that imitates the spiritual body. So one who thinks this body is all in all, that he is this body, and then bodily relatives are my relatives, then he works for his self-interest of the body. Once I think I am the body, then I have to work for the self-interest. So if you remember that I am the servant of God, then we start working for self-interest of the soul. So we are completely diverted by Maya into forgetfulness of our original consciousness of self-conscious, being self-conscious that I am a servant of Krishna, and misidentifying with this body, therefore forgetting Vishnu, forgetting Krishna. And then with this body, one is trying to, the soul which is inherently seeking existence, knowledge, eternal existence, knowledge and bliss, that is trying to express itself through this mechanism, through this physico, psycho, bio mechanism, yantra. That is why Krishna calls it as a yantra, not an ordinary yantra, a robot which can think, feel and will in your presence. It can create the illusion of thinking, feeling, willing. Just like in a movie, you watch the character in the movie is nothing but dead matter, light patches, isn't it? But when the soul sees it, when you see the screen, then you give all life symptoms to that dead matter. The character on the screen is thinking, feeling, willing. Is it really thinking, feeling, willing? No. It can create a perfect duplication of thinking, feeling, willing, so that if you simply see, you identify, you think that character is alive. In the same way, this is a robot. This body is a fantastic robot. A robot which has got a manufacturing date and an expiry date. So, in the material world, all the jivas, unlimited robots with manufacturing date and expiry date. And they are all aging. Expiry date means they are all aging. Everybody is aging. But nobody thinks of this. Everybody thinks, I will remain in this body forever. I am this body. My friends, my relatives are all this. This is such a big illusion. It's a stark reality. Nothing more starker than that reality, that we are in a growing body. So I can't be this body. Somebody who is within this body is me, who is experiencing babyhood, childhood, youthhood, old age, then birth, death, all this. I am the experiencer of all these things, but I am not that. And here in this context, then how to awaken this? If somebody has a curse like this, then he will not awaken. Krishna says, Mata smriti jnanam apoharam cha. I am seated within the heart of all living entities. From me comes knowledge, remembrance and forgetfulness. So that awakening of self-knowledge, theoretical, philosophical understanding, I am servant of God, servant of Krishna, is a philosophical understanding, but it's not awakening. If you have to awaken, then you need the mercy of the Lord. We have to understand the situation and desire the lotus feet of the Lord. We have to desire that we go back to Him. Once we have that strong desire, then the Lord is seated in everybody's heart. He will guide the living entity to a guru, to a spiritual master. And whose instruction one will follow, one has to follow. And then awaken one's consciousness, Krishna consciousness. If one awakens one's Krishna consciousness, then he will see all this robotic world, robotic tamasha. He'll just see this as a tamasha. Sukha, dukha, sex life. Nothing to do with the soul. Male, female, there are different types of robots. Type 1, type 2 robot. Type A, type B. Nothing personal about it. It is so superb that it looks so personal. But the so-called personalism is completely impersonal. That personalism is injected by the person who is sitting in the body. Body itself has no personality. The soul which is sitting in the body, through false ego, false identification, just like pure white light, you put a green glass, green light will come out. Or a red glass, red light will come out. Or pure white light, you put a lion mask, the other side you'll see a lion face. You put a tiger mask, translucent tiger mask, you will see a tiger face. So you will say that light, this is a tiger light. You will say this is a, you know, monkey light, or whatever, depends on the light is light. It is the mask. That mask is called false ego. This body is that mask. Or my pure consciousness is coming through this body, through process called identification. And therefore, when it comes out, my consciousness, just like light is changing colors, taking shape, my consciousness takes shape of male, female, all these things. So unless we get the mercy of the Lord, Somebody may say, what's wrong with all these things? This, okay, this is the way the Lord has created. Let me enjoy my life. The whole problem is you cannot, the soul needs sat, eternal knowledge. Soul needs eternal happiness. Soul needs eternal love. Soul wants all these things eternal, sat. But here everything is asat. You have loving relationships. Either you don't have loving relationships. You expect loving relationship and you don't get love. Or if you get love, then at the time of death, you have to repay all that by that much dukkha. What is the point? What the point in cultivating love with somebody else in this material world other than God? Because it all ends. It's so funny that the lover also ends. Lover is a false ego. That mask also ends. So in the material world, the identity of the lover is false, the identity of the loved is false, and love is false. And what is true? The experience for the soul is true. But is the soul satisfied with that experience? No. Soul needs eternal love, unbreaking love, pure love, unconditional love. That is not there in the material world. It cannot be. Not possible. So material world, Maya is designed, the material world is designed in such a way that every one of us fail in our search for Satchit Ananda. Every one of us fail. Whether he's a brahmachari or a grihastha or vanaprastha or sannyasi, everybody fails in Satchit Ananda. Unless one identifies himself as a servant of Krishna, till that continuously Maya makes you a failure. Just like one brahmachari was asking always to me, what is the perfect, how to, okay, Prabhupada has allowed grihastha ashrama, Prabhu, how to choose the right kind of girl so that I don't make a mistake. So that finally, you know, I succeed in married life. So I told him, I had no answer for a long time. He said, good question he's asking. No answer. We are supposed to guide, no. Okay, you're changing ashram now. How? I don't want to make a mistake of getting a wrong girl. So I told him the purpose of marrying in grihastha life is to fail. So does not matter. So don't be so choosy. Does not matter. The purpose is to fail. The spiritual purpose of marriage is to fail. Then only it is a fact, whoever it is, finally you will fail. Because marriage means what? You want companionship, you want love, you want sharing, you want all these things. Forget about people who want sex and get married. That is so foolish it is. If you want sex, you don't get married. It's a very foolish thing. At least people who say, okay, I want love, emotion, I want care, I want sharing, all these things, then you can marry. At least it is worth it. And that, you get beaten up left, right, center. And finally, you will say, failure. I am a failure. As far as this objective is concerned. So that failure is a success. It's a spiritual success. Intelligent people, they say, no, I know it is going to be a failure. That's why I don't want to marry. I'll remain brahmachari. So, these two verses are so indicative of the, in a Vedic society, what was the default objective of every human being? If somebody does not think that Vishnu is his gati, then he is not considered a human being, he is considered an animal. So in this context, everybody in the material world now is an animal who is not Krishna conscious. And simply identifying with this material body as oneself. And why this has happened here, it has happened because particularly, what is the role of curse? Just see, a curse is there. So unless one gets the blessings of a Vaishnava, blessings of the Guru, blessings of the holy name, it is not possible for us to realize this concept that I am not this body, that I am of another substance, I am this consciousness. One will still be in the... So bodily concept of life is a punishment. For those whose attitude is not to surrender to Krishna, it's a punishment. If you don't want to surrender to Krishna, if you don't want to surrender to Guru, you want to surrender to Vaishnavas, you don't want to be servant of the servant of the servant, once servant consciousness is not developed, then till then this bodily concept is a punishment. Like Prabhupada says, body is an embarrassment. So if I think I am the body, what an embarrassment it is. Because you see, this body is so dirty, blood, mucus, meat. It's a meaty, bloody body. Meaty, blood, full of blood. Meaty, mucus, blood. So this is an embarrassment or not? If I say, okay, this is what you are, if somebody tells you, oh, you are this many kilos of meat, you'll get very angry, no? You are this many kilos of meat, this much liters of blood, this much this thing. You tell the scientist also, that's what you are. According to your science, only that much you can see. That's what you are. So it's an embarrassment. Those who have a feel of what is eternity, what is soul, what is permanency, for them it is an embarrassment. So curse, if you get the curse, if you make offenses, you'll go into bodily concept. If you make offenses, you'll indulge in sex, illicit sex. You make offenses, you'll fall down. Why? Because the consciousness gets covered. Just see, the curse here is making, the curse is to, you know, be in bodily concept. All the brahmanas are told, you continue in the cycle of repeated birth and death. So very instructive that how bodily concept is a punishment. Because here, Nandishwara got angry and he wanted to punish the brahmanas and Daksha. He wanted to punish. And what is the punish? You shall remain in bodily concept of life. Which means by default they were not bodily concept of life. That is human life. Any questions?
I was discussing with one boy regarding body and spirit.
Regarding?
Body and spirit. Atma. Body and spirit. Body and...
Body experience.
Body and spirit, Prabhu.
Body and spirit.
So the discussion was going like that, and he was asking one question: marriages are made in heaven. So how the identity is carrying forward from one life to another life?
How the
identity of the body?
Identity of?
Because we are not the body. How the marriages are fixed in heaven? Something like that he was asking.
Because false egos are fixed.
False egos.
False egos are fixed. In your chitta, in your contaminated consciousness, false egos are and so matching is all. That's called destiny. So these are all interactions of the three modes of material nature. False ego means identifying with this particular body. So many we have so many misconceptions of self, but those are all. Those misconceptions of self, I am this, I am that, I am businessman, I am father, I am mother, these are all role plays. But That is not called false ego. They are called children of false ego. They are offshoots of false ego. False ego is what? I am this material body. Who is I? I am this body. That is called false ego. So that false ego, I am this body, where is that I am that body? Because body is body. Body doesn't say I am the body. Where is that I am the body? That is another element called false ego. Body doesn't say I am the body. You say I am the body. So body is separate, I am the body is separate. So I am the body goes and sits in your chitta, in your consciousness, contaminated consciousness. And then based on that self, that means that goes and covers the real self. I am servant of Krishna. You say, I am this body. And then whole life expands like that. So for that kind of, for that false ego, when you have taken body, particular body in this life, then marriages are made in heaven. Means it's same destiny. It is destined. Somebody will come. But devotee's destiny changes. Because once you surrender to Krishna, Prabhupada and Krishna, for us, surrendering to Krishna is a big word. Surrendering to Prabhupada means simple. Four regulative principles and chanting 16 rounds. Very merciful, only five things. Surrendering to Prabhupada. So once you surrender to Prabhupada, he takes charge of our life. And then he will take charge of our destiny. There's a continuous dynamic relationship between guru and the disciple. And what he has to go through, what he has to teach, all those things. As long as he is sticking to the spiritual master's instructions, then he'll go through all those things. And then destiny, how destiny has, not that your destiny will be wiped out and he'll create a new destiny. No, your destiny he will manage. He and Krishna will manage. Some destiny he wants to keep, he will keep. Something he wants to change, he will change. Something not in your destiny, he will come and give also. That also. So nothing is fixed like that for the devotee unless he believes that everything is fixed. As you have faith, according to that, you know, nobody is going to forcefully change your faith. No, I am destined to be grass. If you say, okay, be grass. Or if there is some destiny is to be grass, and the spiritual master sees that he is very fastly, very quickly, he is advancing and understanding and everything, then he will say, he would have changed the destiny. Why he should marry? Not required. Like that. Any other question? Grandharachimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.